She was one of us, telling stories from the trenches. But one day, she was gone, only to reemerge, still as a storyteller, but this time, telling tales of the imagined kind, putting together prose that sing the triumphs of the human spirit, the silence of tragedies. Marga Ortigas has been all over the world, yes, writing and writing and telling stories. But give her a blank paper, a blank screen. Leave her alone with her thoughts, and she is home. And her two pieces, The House at Calle Sombre and There Are No Falling Stars in China and Other Life Lessons from a Recovering Journalist, brings her readers into her world, sometimes wanting to stay indefinitely, sometimes wanting to leave right away. That's the power this author holds. Marga Ortigas joins us today, one of the remarkable women we honor this month. Marga, welcome to the program. Hi. Nice to see you again.
Nice to see you, Carmina. Thank you. That was some introduction. Thank you very much. I'm very honored.
Well, thanks for taking time out to be with us. Last time you were together, Marga, you were telling me how you were not supposed to be there during that dinner because you were still writing No Falling Stars then, putting on the finishing touches. And now that it's out and to rave reviews at that, how are you feeling?
A bit relieved, but also I made the mistake of not giving myself enough time to take a break. So I might be done with book number two, but I gave myself the task of having to finish book three and book four at a deadline. So like that dinner that I did see you at, I gave myself a little reward and I thought I could go out and grab a meal with a few friends and then go back to the edit, which is exactly what I did that night. And so now that the fourth manuscript has been turned into the publisher, now I can kind of maybe sleep for about 2-3 months and catch up and get some of my energy back and reconnect with the outside world.
The outside world, Marga, it's waiting for you. It misses you. Anyway, tell us about the changes that you've seen in yourself. I mean, from book one, now that the fourth manuscript is out, it's out there, it's done. Any changes that you saw in the way you told stories and the way you were able to connect to yourself as well?
Yes, actually, it was quite each book, and there are four very different manuscripts, which you will see, you know, when book three and book four come out. I'm kind of worried people might think, is this even written by the same person? Because it might seem a little like there are multiple personalities behind each of the stories. The first one, as you mentioned, was a novel, and it was almost like a love letter, if you will, to the Philippines and all the many years that I spent here and all the many years that I covered the news stories out of here as well. The second book is nonfiction and more a collection of all the essays that I kept to myself while traveling throughout the world. For the last two decades and covering international news stories. The third one is a bit of an adventure type mystery set across the Southeast Asian islands and the Pacific. So I don't want to say it's one of those thrillers because it's not quite that. It's still a bit of a literary work, but it's looking at the region as a whole. A story told from the tropical islands that nobody ever quite looked at in this particular way. And then the fourth one is again another work of nonfiction, which is very different from There Are No Falling Stars in China. But each one is almost a bit therapeutic for me. And every time I put the words down on the page, it was a way for me to kind of deal with certain periods, I suppose, in my life and then let it go. So I haven't looked back at books that have been published. Once they're out there, they're out there, and I've not reopened them. Yeah. I think for fear of finding typos, for fear of finding things that I might wish I could have rewritten, It's out.
Later on, we're going to talk more about, you know, what makes you decide from going to one kind of storytelling to another and all that and all the good stuff that happens behind the scenes. But I do want to go back to the very beginning. I mean, you were in the newsroom. As I said, you were one of us. What made you decide to venture out of the newsroom and into this whole new world? Go ahead.
I got tired. I don't want to say it. I started fairly young for the industry. I was in my teens, really, and I was still in university when I began in local news. And, you know, the job then was watching the 24-hour news that was pumped out by an international network. It was the first Iraq war, and we had to basically summarize what was going on and produce hourly news bulletins. So I was presenting at a young age, and then that was several years. I joined a, you know, multi-awarded news magazine program, the Probe Team. Mm-hmm. And then eventually I went on to the United Kingdom where I did my master's. But all of that was in the hopes of eventually still doing journalism, which I did do. I joined CNN, was with CNN for a few years, and then I went on to Al Jazeera, where I came back to Asia and did the news from the region for an international audience. Mm-hmm. All in all, that was all 25 plus years. And it kind of takes a toll on your body because, you know, you're out rough roads, you're climbing mountains, you're falling into rivers, you're getting muddied. It is more physical, I think, than I was prepared for. And eventually it did take a toll. We were involved in several car accidents. I never did anything about the injuries. And then eventually even just getting out of bed became very, very difficult. So I decided to take a break. And I had always wanted to write the books. I thought, okay, now that I've stepped back from news, maybe I can do that novel I always wanted to write. I didn't think it would be a more permanent break than originally planned. I had originally asked for 6 months leave, and then it became a year. And then I just kind of haven't really been in the space, I suppose, mm-hmm. to go back and do news full time. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean I've disappeared, because I am doing consulting with news channels. I am training young reporters. I am teaching in that sense. So I'm passing on what I was fortunate enough to learn from those that came before me. And I want to help the younger generation be the best that they can be it comes to becoming storytellers themselves.
Yeah, but Marga, there is that point between that decision when you said to yourself, I'm going to write a book, right? And the other point, which is, I'm going to first put my first word down onto the keyboard or the paper. Tell us about that little space, that little moment. How nerve-wracking was that for you?
I think a part of me didn't think it would actually happen. You know, everybody can, you can kind of say, oh, I'm going to write a book. Yeah, I'm going to write a book, and never actually do it. And then there was one day I was just, I think I was sitting in a coffee shop just appreciating the fact that I could just sit in the coffee shop. And I took out a piece of paper and I just started, the first thing I did with the first book was plot the family tree. I thought, you know, you start to see characters, and then I started to plot the family tree, and then I gave it a title. And what am I going to call this? And then I started giving them all names, and then I gave them faces. Like, I literally plotted them with actors' faces so that I knew what each of the character would look like. And that also in a way helped drive how the plot went. Mm. But once that started to happen, I was like, oh wow, this is getting more and more real. And so every day I would just put a little bit more and a little bit more. And then I started to outline a story. And then it was a little bit more and then a little bit more. And then maybe weeks after that, I sat down in front of an empty screen, just staring at the page. And it was literally, so I'm calling it this. I had the title before anything else. And I thought, what am I going to do now? And that's why it begins, the first chapter begins with The House Stood. Because that was the first thing I thought, let me describe the house. And I just started writing. And from there, it just sort of flowed. It just sort of came out. So I didn't believe it myself until I got to the end.
Yeah, and it reminds you of that moment, you know, as journalists, when we begin to write down a story and we're just waiting. There's a term that we use. I don't know if you use that too. You're waiting for sapi, waiting to get possessed, right, by the spirit to just write.
It, but yes, thank you very much. That's exactly right. You know, I feel like if somebody overheard you, right, it makes you sound very strange.
And I know. Like,
what are they talking about? You know, but it's at some point you're like, you just let the words take you, and you're kind of surfing the words, you know.
And so what happened to you was like, Margaret, what happened to you was sort of like sappy on steroids, because you were just going at it.
Sort of, yes, you can say that. It was like 500 pages later, how'd that happen, you know? Yeah.
Was there were there any moments of doubt, Marga, as you were writing, whether it's this or the second or the third or the fourth?
Every single step of the way. And that's why it took as long as it did with the first book, because I was doubting everything. And I write, this is where the TV background comes in. When I write in print, if you've read the book, you'll kind of notice, I write with a certain rhythm.
Yeah.
And it's not because it's like, I'm not trying to write poetically in that sense where there's rhyme, but I write to be heard aloud. So when you're reading the words that are down on the page, it's actually better if it's heard aloud. And even because when we read, right, you're technically reading those words aloud to yourself in your head. So my sentences, I know people, I've driven grammar Nazis crazy because they're like, that's not where a comma should go. Why is that a period? That's not a sentence. Why is it? But it's written to be read aloud.
Yeah.
And that's thanks to the TV training, because that's how journalists speak on TV. You're speaking into the air, right? Mm-hmm. You're speaking to be heard. Mm-hmm. So that's how I did it. And at every step of the way, I'm like, readers are going to hate this. The editor's going to hate this. No publisher's going to want this. What am I doing? And I just, at the whole time, I kept pushing myself forward by saying, bahala na, you've gotten this far. If this is what's coming out, trust the sapi, right? Just trust what it is that's moving you forward. So that's what I did. And then it was really bahala.
Yeah, because you know? I was going to ask you, women most especially, you know, we hear a lot of voices of doubt. Right, women most especially, either because of an intergenerational influence, cultural influence as well. But I was going to ask you, how were you able to make your voice, your inner voice, louder than the inner doubt you were hearing?
My inner voice is so loud sometimes. I wish it was quiet. What happens is, you know, I might have the doubt, but then at the same time, I think, if I listen to the doubt, what's that going to do for me? Will that bring me any kind of joy? If it won't, then why am I going to listen to it? If it's just going to make me miserable, I'm going to ignore it. And I literally just told myself, I have to trust my gut. And if this is what I feel it needs to be, I'm going to go with it. And whatever happens, happens, and I will deal with it then. So you know, it was like, if no publisher wants it, fine, I'll keep going, or I'll find a way to get it out there regardless. Unless I was completely told by, you know, numerous people, this is really not worth being read by other people. Then maybe it would never have seen the light of day. But maybe not. Maybe I would have just tweaked it in a way that I was still happy with it, and then push it out that way. Maybe self-publish. You know, there are many options that exist, so that you don't have to believe the naysayers.
Which brings us to the next question, Marga. I mean, when you, here in the newsroom, right, you submit a script and you're like, your heart is in your throat, and you know, the whole editing experience. But how is it different from submitting your manuscripts of your novels, of your pieces? How is the editing experience different from the newsroom to, you know, your copy editor?
Well, because there were 500 pages, it was 500 times what you might go through with a new script, which the longest sometimes is 2 pages. And then even that is just half the page, because the other half of the page, you're writing your visual script, if you will. So it was nerve-wracking, especially with the first book, because I didn't know how they would take to the writing's voice. I wasn't sure if it was something that they could understand, relate to, or even want to kind of keep. You know, I was worried that they would turn around and say, this is not going to work. No reader is going to understand this book. Change it entirely. But fortunately, I was with a publisher who, they trust their authors. It's a very collaborative exercise. So we're assigned a structural editor. They go over your script, whatever questions they might have, they will send you back the document with the questions. You then clarify if it's something that needs to be clarified in the text. You do that. They're very helpful. It was a very much a give and take, you know. And then after that, it goes into a copy edit, and then somebody else will look over everything to make sure that the way you've written the text itself transmits what you mean for it to transmit. And in all of that, ultimately, they still rely on the author, because if the author then says, I'm not very comfortable with the changes that you put here, then it discussion. It's not an edict. It's not a, no, this is the way it has to be, and that's that. So at every point, the publisher was also very respectful of the author as, in a way, the owner of the story.
I want to talk about Calle Sombre now. You're reading the pages. You really have a way of writing the seemingly familiar, that it leaves the readers glued to the pages. Does that make sense? And it sometimes it's very experiential, as I would call it. You smell the cigarettes when you the cigarette smoke, right? And you find yourself in you know that particular scenario where the one of the characters is. No, but where did you get that style? You were talking about how you write. There's a rhythm. There's a cadence to it. But it was very experiential too, Marga. Where did you get that?
I think that also comes down to being a journalist, because when we're out in the field, right, you can't just be relying on what the camera is recording or what the sound is recording. You also have to be paying attention to absolutely everything. And I always paid attention to what people might be whispering in the corner that's not exactly seen on camera, to what the room might have smelled like, to what emotion I might be picking up from the people in the area that's not being transmitted in the words that they're saying. So I was always very curious and very aware, I think, of my surroundings. So I put all, and I found that all of that really informs the story, sometimes even more than what is said. Mm-hmm. So I made sure to hear all of that to really create a scene and an experience for the reader in the book, because I felt like all of that could tell you more about the story than the words that I might put down in the dialogue or in describing the action. It really had to do with creating a scene, because I think all of life is experiential, right? So I wanted that reflected as well in the book, because I wanted the reader to feel like they were there. Whether they wanted to, as you put it in the beginning, if they wanted to escape it, that's great, because it's still meant you felt it, you were there.
Yeah, and then came Falling Stars. I remember talking to you about this, and I was like, give me the next book, give me the next book. I want the same of Calle Sombre. But you said, nope, you're stepping away from there, from that style first. But why was there a deliberate choice not to go the Calle Sombre route?
I think I got, again, it was one of the things where, like, I lived with the characters for so long. I think it took me 3 years, because of all the doubt and all the stepping back, it took me 3 years to complete Calle Sombre, the manuscript. And I needed a cleansing of the palate for a little bit, like to step away from it and write something else. And the tone, I'm sure you noticed, is very different. Like, whereas one might seem much darker, an exploration of the light via the darkness, if you will, right? The other one, ironically, looking at the new stories that I did, is slightly more optimistic and a bit more hopeful in how it looks at the human experience. So I think maybe I needed that for myself as well. And we were all just coming out of the pandemic at that stage. And I think we all needed a little bit of lightness to look at. So I think that's why I went that way right after something like Opera.
And when you were talking about the your publisher just a while ago, you're sticking with the same, right? From the first to the fourth, you still have the same publisher. How important was it for you that they respect that this is how you want to go? Because some publishers would want the same kind of formula.
You're right. And that's why, in a sense, I'm very lucky that the publisher has treated me, or, and from what I understand, with all of its authors, it's the same way. It respects where the author is. I originally signed up for the first book, and then the next three books I pitched separately. So I was really just under contract for Sombra, and then after that I had the idea for the other three. So I thought, well, why not submit it to them and see if they want it. And fortunately they did, and they wanted all three, which I wasn't expecting. So I was like, well, okay then. And then they kind of plotted out which book they wanted first, and then how could I finish the books according to the schedule that they might have wanted to release them in, and we discussed that a little bit. And so this is where we're at. So the next book that's coming out after Stars is another novel, another work of fiction, and then the next nonfiction will come out after that.
Okay.
It just so happened that they agreed. They could very well have said we're not interested, and I'm didn't say that.
You've been surrounded in your, both in your career as a journalist and now as an author, right? You've been surrounded you've been surrounded by great storytellers, women storytellers, even when you were starting as a young journalist. Do you hear me? Can you hear me, Marga?
I seem to have lost the audio. Give me a moment.
Okay. I'm talking right now. I'm talking right now, and Marga Ortiga is on screen trying to figure out the audio. We have it? You have us back?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So as I was saying, earlier on in your career, you were surrounded by, you know, great women storytellers, right? And even now as an author, you're exposed to that as well. What makes women good and great storytellers, Marga? Tell us.
I think it's because, I don't want to generalize, but women, in a sense, I guess, historically have been expected to stand back, right? And because we stand back a little bit more than the men might be expected to, I think we pay attention more to what's happening around us. And because we're paying attention more, we are then better able to put things together or understand what's happening in a different way to somebody who is more proactive or more involved in the activity that we are then witnessing. Again, I don't mean to generalize, but I'm just saying maybe in a historical context that can explain why women are, the nuances in the way a woman tells a story might be very different to the way a man might. And the things that we pick up even when we're working on the field will be very different. And that's something I touch upon as well in There Are No Falling Stars in China, where at one stage we were an all-woman team in one particular story. And because we were all women, we were able to tell a very different story than a man might have, because we were allowed into certain places that men were not allowed. And they spoke to us differently because we were women. Mm. So I think it's just each individual, really, and not just limited to the gender, will attack stories very differently. And that's why the very same event can be covered by many different reporters in a variety of ways. And that's because I think we bring our entirety as individuals in the way we then tell the stories that we witness.
And I want to wrap up this conversation, Margo, with this final question. And I feel like before I ask you this, I feel like we need to have a drink of some sort to just really ponder on what you're about to say. But what is that one story that you're just really waiting to tell, whether it's as a journalist or as an author?
You know, I think it might change, because at one stage, that one story I really wanted to tell was Sombra. Just because I felt it was a story that I think I had always wanted to see out of the Philippines. And, you know, they always say, tell the story you'd like to read. And that's what I did with Sombra. And then I thought I was done. And then suddenly the stories that came out that are in No Falling Stars from China just started to kind of repopulate my brain, if you will. And I was like, oh yeah, I wish I could, you know, maybe I should write. And then you start to put things down, and it just felt like, maybe I should put this in a book and share it with people. And of course, you know, you have friends or colleagues who are like, oh, you really should tell that story about that time in Poland, or oh, you really should tell that story about this. And I was very aware of the fact that these were experiences that are not available to the many. So if it made a mark on me and I learned something from it, maybe I can share what I took from it with other people. And that's what I did with There Are No Falling Stars. And then the next book, it was that. Again, it was another story that, it's not exactly like it was sitting at the back of my head this whole time, but it just started to bubble up to the surface. And so I went with it, and that's where the third book came from. And same with the fourth. So it's more like maybe it's what's inside rises to the surface when it's time. Maybe that's what it is. And then at some stage, I begin to just start to listen to it and try to capture it and put it down on the page.
And finally, Margo, you know, listening to you, you're one of the lucky ones, right, who were given the opportunity to sort of lead another life, right? Women most especially, we're expected to sort of lead a linear life. After this, you move on to this. After this, you move on to this. But not the case with you. What do you tell women now who do want to sort of, venture out of that linear life that they lead, but they're just afraid, or the doubts, I think, are louder than that inner voice.
I think it's really the fear. It's the fear that is our biggest traitor. I think we are so fearful to veer off the path that we have been told to be on that we chain ourselves, often to the unhappiness of not just ourselves, but the people around us, right? And the thing with me is, like you had mentioned, we're of a generation where things were still very easily plotted out. You went to school, after school, you got a job, after you get a job, you get married, you start a family. You know, there was a plan that was already in existence, and you just kind of had to slot yourself into that. And what happened with me is that as much as I thought I had this plan, kind of like life had other plans for me, because nothing worked out the way I had thought it would. And so I had to constantly pivot and adjust and pivot and adjust. And through doing that, you learn to go with the flow. And at the end of the day, I can't necessarily say this is what I had planned for myself, but I learned that even in the best of times, sometimes life has other plans for us that turn out better than we ourselves could have ever imagined. So I think I just learned to go with the flow and released fears very early on. But it's not to say that I'm not afraid, because of course we all still have our fears. Do you know what I mean? That's part and parcel of being human. But what I've learned to do is not be chained by it. I might be afraid of something, but what I then do is just go head first into it so that I can get over it. It's like, I don't like living in the fear, so I'm just gonna do it, or I'm just gonna attack it so that I'm done with it and I'm no longer afraid. And that's kind of how I've dealt with things as they've come along. So what can I say to women these days? Trust your gut, trust your gut. And no matter what, I firmly believe you can't make a mistake. So go and try it out. Go and dip your toe in the water. Go and try to chase that dream. And if it doesn't work out, I am sure it would lead you to something else that might be better for you anyway, or that might bring you greater joy than you had originally anticipated. So just trust yourself and then trust the flow of your life.
Margo Artigas right there, journalist and author, one of the remarkable women we honor this month. Thank you for paving the way. Really appreciate it.
Thank you.
I'll see you soon. The outside world is waiting, Marga.
Thank you, Carmina. Thanks. Thank you.